recommended bands to come out on this preseason patch. And Soraka removed straight away. We need to talk to Stress after this one and say, yes, she is incredibly strong. Just so hard to deal with now.
That's why her win rate isn't very high, Stress. It's always bad. Let's
exactly
be fair. Soraka
right
is disgusting right now.
Filthy.
It's to do with the exact same reason that Dr. Mundo is.
Oh,
the
God.
Mastery changes.
Yes. And, of course, the Grievous Wounds changes as well. The fact that it's only on that self-healing. Whoever's actually trying to heal themselves with the Grievous Wounds is going to have more of a trouble. But Soraka, she can happily just go and take all her health away and throw it on somebody else as much as she deems fit. But Rek'Sai going to be banned away from Revolta here, of course, playing that a heck of a lot recently. But it does leave a lot of champions up. I mean, Jax is there as well, Aurelia banned away, another one of those Rageblade users. But I'm just going through in my mind, anyone that can use a Rageblade?
Jax.
Jax is going to be there.
He's still definitely worth considering. Now, Aurelia in particular taken
what?
Away from Lep, because he's a Wicked main.
Yeah.
And not an Aurelia main. So he's a very smart decision as the rest of the bands come out.
Thankfully, Malphite is still available. But yeah, the Rammus, an odd one, might mean that the Brazilian side may want to go towards something of an AD type mid laner, something like that. Of course, Rammus pretty fantastic against the likes of a Yasuo, something like that. But Misfortune was left up and wasting no time. BRTT going to be taking that Misfortune into the bottom lane. And that damn double up does so much damage.
And the fact that you can acquire new targets and give them that love tap every
yeah
single time, if you can effectively swap between a minion and a champion, or both champions in that bottom lane, Misfortune is super dangerous, needs to be respected, and a very, very good first pick.
Very appropriate that he was the player that proposed as well, with the love tapping that can go on. But Thresh and Jack's going to be locked in here. Helior going to put on his carry pants here. I have a feeling that there may be a Rageblade in response. We'll see. But Revolta, if I remember back to IWCI, I think he played an Amumu there too.
Let's not count our chickens till they hatch.
That's a very good point, but I'm just excited.
I do want to touch on the Jax. We mentioned how good Rageblade is on him. Well, he doesn't actually need another item. If Jax gets
yep
a Rageblade, he can just walk around with 10k gold in his pocket and still be able to 1v1 everybody and backdoor the Nexus, because Jax is just that good with the item.
Yep, item efficiency, ladies and gentlemen. That is exactly 10k over efficient for a Jax. Probably not quite that much.
I think it's about 2k.
Yep, goodbye Amumu. There's 17 seconds now on the clock here for the Brazilian side to lock in their next couple of choices, but Arce now with a pretty standard Thresh pickup there on the bottom side. Not going to see any Sonas or anything interesting like that, but it is going to be the Elise and Bard here for Loop. So already with the bottom lane locked down here for Brazil.
And remember 5.22, I don't think it was a hot fix. I believe it was 2.3 where they changed the chimes and
yeah
when they are actually available for this Bard. So a little bit of a disadvantage, 15
seconds.
You might
have to be in lane at the start of laning phase.
It's unfortunate,
oh,
isn't it? Yeah.
You don't want to do that, not as a Bard.
But again, they do lock that Bard in with the Elise, and that is a nice shout out from White Lotus.
Yeah. Oh dear. Flashbacks. Flashbacks.
Yeah, it wasn't that ideal.
No.
Saying that?
Yeah, there's the Evelynn locked in and the Kalista, no surprise there at all. Teamed up with the Thresh, of course. So many different skin options now for like making sure that they're as synchronized as possible. But the Evelynn there for Thiac in the jungle.
Yeah, they've locked in that Evelynn. They've got the Kalista as well. So the Kalista Thresh in particular, very strong bot lane. Evelynn can have a lot of invisible pressure, as she is invisible when she
yep
walks around
well
in the jungle.
Well stated.
So not
well
only
stated
changes the warding patterns of this Brazilian side, it also changes how they have to play, when they can be aggressive, and if they even think they can be, because Evelynn could be around the corner at any moment.
Yep, that is a very good point. But, you know, that Evelynn could be assassin Eve in the mid lane with a Rageblade. Who knows?
I'm not going to ride off the Rageblade.
I've heard that it's strong. I tried it. Didn't do very well, but I'm also not very good. So we'll see whether that does come out. But against the Victor might be difficult here, as that's going to be the hover here for Kami. 4 seconds to go. And Lep is going to take away the Malphite there as well. So no Rammus. We're going to still have a heck of a lot of armor. Put that big rock in the top lane, and it's a lot of AoE damage, what with that Misfortune as well.
Yeah, but he's gone for a Malphite into a team comp that's already got an Evelynn jungle. They've got a Jax who does
point
mixed damage
yeah
as well in that top lane. It is almost entirely mixed damage, and it's on them now to pick whatever they would like mid, which does now indicate to me a mage.
Yeah, well,
why
precisely
would you go an AD into Malphite?
You're not going to, and especially when, you know, the likes of the Yasuo and Zed are there. Of course, Yamato Cannon has come out and said that Zed still fairly strong, but I believe 5.23.
2.3 strong, yeah.
Yeah, so 1v1 might be good. Not so much on 5.22, which is where we are now. we'll see what the Latin Americans do decide to pick up. But they're taking their time.
Could default to it. Like, he does play a lot of Jace. I would say he defaults to an Azir or something that's like a more control mage type of AP. Jace, obviously, as mentioned, not a great idea into that team comp that they have. So Lissandra, something like Azir would be pretty good.
Yeah, well, Lissandra is what they're going to go for here. Frozen Tomb going to be available for a lot of extra AoE. Might give Helior some room to move around this map as well. And they've just got a lot of AoE control. Lots of slows, the Qs that can be thrown out a whole lot there by that Lissandra, as well as that Agony's Embrace from Evelynn really slowing down a whole team. And we'll see whether that means that Helior gets the space that he needs just to thwack on people's faces.
So it's a very good control team, but it's very hard to execute. They've got an Evelynn who doesn't guarantee the engage. They've got a Jax who needs to be next to the target to guarantee the stun, and it's not instant either. He needs to stay there for a prolonged period of time or jump at them. Lissandra's the only guaranteed one besides potentially a Thresh Hook, but it's so execution heavy. Whereas you have a look at CB LoL's side here, they've got a Malphite to go in, they've got the Elise Cancun, they've got the Misfortune to follow it up as well as the Victor. So if one connects, they all connect, because not even that, there's still a Bard to boot.
Yeah, they just all press their R button and hope that Loop doesn't. Because that could be a big problem.
Not at the exact same time, anyway.
No, please don't do that.
Yeah.
No tempered fates like I experience in solo queue. That's just not exactly what we want. But, of course, Loop's not going to be doing that. Man's pretty good at the old Bard. So we'll see how things are going to go and whether the Pressar comp is going to beat the sort of kite comp, the one that's trying to really control the flow of the game as opposed to just press all their buttons.
Yeah, it is definitely a lot about kite. One thing that you do need to keep your eye on is that bottom lane here from the Latin American side. They can go in, they can go out. They've got the team to work around that as well. So if they want to go, they can go 10 times harder than you would assume. The question then is, can this Brazilian side come back with the teleports maybe from the top lane, get really in their face and bring it to them as well?
Yeah, well, we'll have to see. We are going to be hopping onto the Rift very, very soon, ladies and gentlemen. Of course, Brazil taking on Latin America for our first Summoner's Rift match of All-Stars here at IWCA. And as you can see, Loop running out of base already. And we'll see. Are the level ones going to change a whole lot here as well, Rusty, considering the fact that everything starts off a little bit earlier? And with a pause, we have plenty of time to discuss it.
Yeah, so I don't think there'll be level one invades, especially like not with this particular team comp. The Evelynn does want to do her own jungle camp, to say the least. I think you want to get that blue buff, start putting some pressure maybe on the second camp. There is the chance, though, of a lane swap because of the Rift Herald, which has been mentioned on the desk by Yamato Cannon. You can lane swap, you can pressure that objective because the first one is more valuable than the first dragon, because the first dragon is a scaling objective, whereas the Rift Herald is immediate.
Yeah, not to mention the fact that you want to be pushing down these turrets early. Try and get that objective advantage, get that extra global gold, and try and get yourself forward that way. Because we've experienced on this patch as well, the things can snowball out of control relatively quickly. The fact that the games have gone down in pace, I mean, sorry, down in length, is something that could be definitely attributed to that. And we'll see whether the Rift Herald is going to give these teams a little bit more room to move towards that sort of end.
That's right. And it's also a lot easier now to siege in lane swaps as well, because they reduced a lot of the stuff on the turrets. Now it's a flat health amount. Makes it very easy, of course. Around the 7-8 minute mark, it's very difficult to siege that turret because the base health increases. But if they can do it early, if they can lane swap, they can get some small advantages, move that to the Herald, take the Herald mid, and then just siege their way down that lane. There's a lot of power plays that you can make now with the Herald as well as the Baron. If the Dragon is traded for it, you would never really call it worth.
No, you wouldn't. And especially considering the fact that the Brazilian lineup is actually fairly well suited to fast pushing down turrets. They have that Elise, the long range auto attack, able to stand next to the creep wave, smack down those turrets with the bottom lane if they do get there. And of course, Misfortune, she does a bit of damage at the moment.
Yeah, she does a fair chunk of damage. Has that attack speed steroid as well, as she wants to put levels into the W. So very good at taking down turrets. They're not as good at 5v5 sieging unless they dive. That's the big question mark. If the Elise can get a pick, or if the Bard can get a stun or the ultimate to connect, they can wombo that. But if they're just trying to siege, it's not necessarily that easy to take it down. In saying that, if you have a look at the Latin American side, the Evelynn needs to flank. So if they just brute force their way in, they can actually siege very well. It comes down, and I've said this time and again for the Latin American side, if they don't execute well, they will end up going behind in this game.
Yeah, and they've chosen a team comp that could be very hard to execute as well. They have a lot of sort of single target burst damage. If they manage to get the warding up, make sure that they have vision of this this Brazilian squad, they will be able to get picks in the jungle. Of course, Death Sentence, pretty fantastic. It's aptly named in that regard. So they will be able to jump down and really try and get something going. But it seemed to be said on the other side. The Brazilians, they've got the Bard stun. They've got all sorts of options in the Cocoon. The fact that Malphite's going to have his ultimate level 6 and just jump on someone if they need to. The pick potential from both sides is very, very high. But it seems like there's just so much extra follow-up from the Brazilians.
And the question is, where are they going to put all of their focus and control then?
Yeah.
Like we mentioned the Rift Herald. Do they actually want to focus around that, use their engage, their pick, or even the Evelynn with that utility of being invisible and try and take down the Herald and then push a lane? Or do they just want to brute force the opposite side of the map because they have a team comp that can siege if it's not being defended?
Yeah, it's a very good point. And it all comes down to coordination here for the Brazilian side as well. And when we're talking about an all-star team, these are players from three different sides. Of course, you've got a couple there from Kaboom. You've also got a couple from Pain. Oh, actually, only one from Kaboom and the other two from INTZ. So these players may not have necessarily played with each other all that much, and having that extra coordination is something that we expect from these top teams, but not necessarily when they've been randomly selected by fans at home in order to come play.
And you know, the best part is the top laner is the one from Kaboom, who by default is not expected to be as proficient as the rest of the team working together. And given the changes to the map now, being on this new patch, having all the new masteries, the fact that you can take down turrets quicker and teleport not being as efficient, you need to use it optimally or you run the risk of making a big mistake for a very long period of time. Not only that, top lane is now involved in the game. He doesn't sit on an island. He actually has to play his part.
Yeah, and you need to make sure that you have control over that Rift Herald, depending on where the lanes shake up as well. You don't know where these players are going to go, whether it's going to be the lane swap or not. But you look over the side of Latin America, and they've got their Shock Caller, potentially, in Heliod there in the top lane. On the Jax at this point as well, very, very strong champion on this patch, able to really mix it up, and we'll see whether he can actually utilize the fact that he may have a potential advantage. Of course, a lot of this is speculation at this stage because we don't know how these teams are going to shake out now that they're all here together, but we'll see whether Helior is going to be able to make that difference.
Yeah, Helior's very, very good at using his teleport. That's the first thing we ever got told about him, is he is so very efficient at using that teleport. He's just not very good at 1v1 laning. And this is why the Malphite pick is honestly still okay. Because if Helior can't actually push that advantage, get a 1v1, and then split push, he has to use teleports, which is something that they will be able to do much better with a Malphite.
Yeah, and it probably helps that he's Jax in this scenario as well. I mean, he is a little bit attack speed reliant, but like you said, a lot of mixed damage, the ability to level up that Empower, that W, make sure that you can smack people with magic damage as much as possible, means that, you know, you're not just going to be able to build that Frozen Heart or Sunfire Cape and just ignore everything that the auto attacker does.
Yes, you're not going to be unkillable.
Yes.
That is the first thing you can take away from this. If LEP stacks armor, he will die to the magic damage. And that is one thing they do have a lot of. So a mixed build. It'll be a mixed bag of items, mixed bag of resistances maybe from LEP. Could just go ability power, do a lot of damage with the ultimate combo as well with the rest of his team. There are still a lot of options for him. He's just not restricted, and in a good way restricted, to one type of resistance, which is where Malphite shines.
Yeah, well, that's exactly right. I want to talk about the AD carries here as well. We mentioned the fact that AD carry is very, very strong on this patch. Lots of changes have happened here. Not a whole lot happened to Kalista. Has anything changed now that new items have come in? Are you going to build her differently, or is it just still going to be Blade of the Rune King, the Hurricane, and just move on from there?
So I would imagine if they're going to change anything in the build, given that the Hurricane can now crit, it would be a static Shiv potentially before the Blade of the Ruined King or a third item. So you can very easily afford to go for crit now just because the Hurricane works very well with it. Runarns is optimal almost for White Lotus to then get the crit. If he doesn't, if he goes for the standard build, it's still going to be perfectly fine. Kalista is still in a very good spot. Wasn't changed a lot. It was just the items.
Yep.
But on the other side, there has been an abundance of changes.
Yeah, we could talk about Ms. Fortune till the cows come home, of course. Essence Reaver does stand out in my mind, but flat damage, the fact that her ult now scales with crit means that you can do all sorts of different things now with this champion. Do you think it's going to be sort of the Essence Reaver into maybe an attack speed item, Infinity Edge, that sort of thing?
I would be shocked if it's not an Essence Reaver. It is ridiculous on Ms. Fortune. Ms. Fortune's ultimate can crit as well.
Yeah.
So if you get an Essence Reaver, and let's say that you crit with your ultimate, you get mana back, and that would be pretty gross.
Yeah, it is.
It's very strong. Ms. Fortune is a champion right now, especially because you can acquire new targets, give them the love tap. The move speed is on the W, the attack speed is on the W as well. So even if you get engaged on, you can press the active and run away safely, and the ultimate actually does a whole lot of damage now.
Yeah, ludicrous amounts of damage. if you pair it with this team comp as well, always when Miss Fortune was getting run before she got changed, it was with, you know, the likes of the Malphite, the like a Moo Moos, the massive Wombo combos. But we'll see whether this one comes off as well, because there are so many other options. But ladies and gentlemen, I believe the pause is just about over. And we'll be getting on to the Rift for our first Summoner's Rift game of day one of IWCA. And you can see Lep and Elior just eyeing each other off.
Yeah, there's not going to be a lot of action again. We questioned just before that pause if an invade was going to come out. Well, if it does, it's going to happen right now.
Yeah, well, White Lotus being caught up. Half health already here as BRTT is getting the auto attacks off. They're not going to flash over. I believe that could have potentially been first blood, but White Lotus still had the flash, still had the heal.
Yeah, he manages to get away. Very smart use of the auto attack to get over that wall, of all things, because I expected the flash. He was super low, and then I did, again, expect the follow-up from BRTT. But it's a very big risk flashing that wall. You have no idea if someone's there.
Yeah, that's a big deal as well, the fact that BRTT did manage to make it up towards that turret and stop the back of White Lotus. Minions have, of course, spawned already halfway up the lane. This could be a potential level advantage for BRTT, as he's just hanging around. You've got Loop helping out with these Krogs for Revolta, but it's Miss Fortune trying to hold this wave as quickly as possible.
Yeah, definitely holding that wave. Of course, helping out the Evelynn with that jungle pathing is going to be very strong as well. We'll see if he actually wants to invade after that blue buff, something that we did say was a definite possibility. This middle lane battle as well, whilst we're talking about it, is going to be very heated, because these control mages, they do damage.
They most certainly do. Loop harassing Arce here on the bottom lane. White Lotus finally making his way back, but already this wave completely pushed up. There's the Counter-Strike actually on the left. Fair bit of extra damage there, as he's already down to half health.
Very amusing at level one. There is a Corrupting Potion, so Helior does a lot of damage if he gets those auto attacks off. That stun at level one, it does help with training, but Malphite's attack speed slowed makes it very hilarious to watch them try and hit each other at all.
Yeah, well, looks like Theak was coming in for a potential gank here on the bottom lane. There is a lot of extra pressure, but decides not to go for it. Just going to take the Rift Scuttler. Going to be spotted by this pink ward here as well, as you can see.
That's early.
Very early.
I was going to say, that pink ward, there has to be a reason it's there this early, and that's Revolta being there to prevent it from going down. Not a bait intentionally, but that's what it almost became just there.
Yeah, he is going to slink away back into his jungle, though, as Loop did come up to try and harass him out. But Kami takes down that Siege minion, couple of CS in the lead. But as far as this mid lane matchup is concerned, haven't seen Lissandra versus Victor all that often.
It's all right for the Lissandra. I'd say it favors the Lissandra ever so slightly. You've got a bit of a mana advantage. The difference now is that, keep in mind, all of these mid laners are running Ignite.
Yeah.
So it's super volatile, to say the least. It could go either way, and I think it comes down heavily to jungle pressure, because in the one versus one, there should be no way that either of them directly die without a mistake.
Yeah, we'll see whether this tournament as well, whether we'll see some Ignites on the top laners, considering the slight nerf to the teleport. Not this game though, as BRTT getting some more auto attacks on the White Lotus. Level 3 now. The Latin American side. Revolta actually getting some invade happening here as Theak taking down his red buff. Does have to be very careful.
He did it.
Yep, there's a cocoon. Lots of damage now. The red buff helping out. He's going to be able to smite it away, but can he get over the wall? No! First blood goes down. Revolta picks it up.
Fantastic use of smite there from Theak to almost get away. Had the flash, didn't actually want to use it.
Yeah.
Because there was no doubt that Elise could potentially even have just aggroed the double golems without even flashing herself, and had the flash available. So
yeah, Repel was also there, I believe.
Didn't run the risk, didn't want to waste anything, instead just does concede. But super smart play here from Revolta to get in the face of this Evelynn.
Yeah, knows exactly what's going on here. We talked up Revolta earlier on. Definitely not making us look silly at this stage, as Seiya takes a death ray, and Kami able to lay down the harass, but still keeping up is this Lissandra.
This is the kind of game on paper where you say Brazil might have a small advantage left.
Yeah, Theak coming in here is 200 health. The flash after him, though, as the hate spikes are coming in. Another two's going to do it, but he's running fairly quickly. One more. There it is, and the Evelynn picks up the kill.
One of the slowest deaths that you will ever see. Only going to get slower as Malphite gets more and more tanky items. Very big pick from this Evelynn, though, to be able to get a kill back in his favor. Save that flash before when he died. Well, he used that positively to get a kill this time. So, all around, good decision.
Yeah, turning that one around, and it might mean that this jungling experience not going to be quite as bad as probably would have seen Revolta paying a little bit more attention to that. Loop hanging around here on the bottom side. See whether he goes to pick up some chimes in a little bit. Leave BRTT to his own devices.
Actually, well done here from this misfortune all around. We were going to say, you know, Kalista, pretty good. Not a lot of changes. Should still be fine once you hit the two item stage. Well, misfortune is just so overbearing in this laning phase that now BF Sword, which is cheaper, 1300 gold, can pick that one up and still be at 45 CS to what was 35 before that recall. So slight catch up here from White Lotus, but advantage well and truly in BRTT's favor.
Yeah, especially now. That extra item advantage. White Lotus, of course, as you mentioned, hasn't quite been back, so we'll be able to at least earn back the discrepancies. And Chimes being picked up here as Double Up not going to find the extra target. Still do need to be careful, of course, the CC combination of this bottom lane. But Revolta's making his way in. The slow does go down from the auto attack of Loop. There's the Dark Passage, though.
Ooh.
As there's the flash out of the way. Arce coming through again, trying to find the turret shots, but he may regret this as BRTT's going to pick up the kill. In they go, White Lotus, he's in trouble as well, is down to 100 health, but man, the Brazilian side turning that one. But Arce, I liked the play, just didn't quite work.
Well, the idea was well and truly there. It was just overpowered by numbers, and that was a ridiculously good repel from that Revolta release. That was unbelievable because it denied a potential trade from White Lotus, who got a little bit over-aggressive, almost went down himself. So all things considered, Latin America, they tried very hard to get that trade positive for them. Brazil executed too well.
They most certainly did, and change up here coming out of the Latin American side is here's a gank in the mid lane. Seiya will need to get over that. Well, flashes into it though, as Arce's here. They do get the turret shots. Tempered Fate not going to be available just yet as the Chaos Storm was there from Kame, but a little bit too aggressive here from the Brazilian team.
And fantastic play from Seiya using the flash W and then the ultimate, comboing all of the damage. There was nothing that Lube could do but go down to the turret. And very easy pickup, but a big oversight from this Brazilian side because the cavalry was there to protect their mid laner.
Incredibly well-timed for Arce to move up that mid lane after getting killed on that bottom side as well. Fiak is going to be able to smite this one away. The Q's going to pick it up there for Seiya. Very low. Evelyn may need to go back to base as Jax is going to be farming underneath his turret. 50 to 61, but that is not going to remain like that for much longer.
No.
We'll see, it is actually Trinity Force picked up first here for the Jax.
Yeah, seemingly so anyway. We'll see if he actually wants to go for the Gwinders at all or just really likes Jax, and he's going to try his best to go in here.
Yeah, well, there's the ultimate. Cocoon lands as well from Revolta. He's everywhere today. He's going to lock down another kill now on the top laner.
Elio, over-aggressive, just wants to try and poke LEP out of lane, just bully him, and it backfires completely because the Malphite ultimate was there, Revolta was there, and they turned that completely on its head because Helior had nothing left up.
Yeah, and Revolta is just making this game his own. You heard Spawn talking about it, the fact that he can take over games on his Lee Sin. I think we can add the Elise to that list, but there's the ultimate coming out from White Lotus.
Oh my
massive
god!
Massive damage from BRTT in response. It's almost going to be a double kill as the shutdown does come in. But man, the trade of supports, that was
misfortune
ridiculous.
Misfortune damage was gross. He almost got a double kill just by pressing R. A single auto attack picks up the next target. And
My god. Okay, Double Up does a bit of damage, guys. We spoke about it before, but didn't quite understand how much. That's just silly.
That was a bait from Latin America. White Lotus is like, Evelyn's here, I'll be fine. And then gets a double up to the face. And now the Ark is taking his farm. The jungler's dream?
Yeah, I guess so. And Nanini carries worst nightmare at the same time. White Lotus just sat back from his computer and just said, not much we can do there. Lep's just going to try and clear out this minion wave in the top lane. Now has his Sunfire Cape completed. Helior going to struggle to get through the Malphite, at least until he has a little bit more augmenting that magic damage. Sheen, of course, without ability power at this point.
Exactly right. And of course, giving that cooldown reduction in mana for this Jax, it is still interesting that he's going for the Trinity Force first. It's more of a skirmish 1v1 type of burst thing, but you know, Gwinzo's honestly does that and a little bit better at the moment.
Most certainly does. And if you can hang around in that creep wave, not only do you keep up your passive, you also keep up that Rageblade as well. It was always why, theoretically, Rageblade was good, except it just wasn't a good item beforehand.
Yeah. It's
in a lot of other people's opinion, I still loved it.
It's definitely good now. And while we're talking about the Rageblade for that top laner, that's an interesting response out of Lef.
Yeah.
Very much indicates he wants the split push, wants to deal with the wave clear that Jax was going to go for. With assumedly, anyway, the Gwynzi's Rageblade.
Yeah, well, looks like the Rift Herald's going to take his first death in competitive League of Legends. So it is going to be taken here from the Brazilian side. I believe Revolta does have it. They're going to head towards the mid lane to try and push that one up with the Baroness minions.
Rest in peace, Harold.
Yeah, Rift Herald.
There's not really, it's not easy for them to siege, because keep in mind the Rift Herald does buff the minions, but it doesn't make them as tanky as the Baron buff.
Yes.
So the wave clear from Lissandra, still a very obvious feature of her kit. The Uck can be there, and they can pretty much prevent the siege from happening. So you need to pick and choose which lane you're going to be in. In saying that, they can die very easily because the minions hurt.
Yeah.
They get a cannon, they get a teleport from the top lane Malphite of Lep. They can.
Well, Sei has been playing this Lissandra fairly expertly at this stage, making sure he stays as safe as possible, getting these Qs to clear out those cast creeps.
Well, here we go.
Yeah, and Arce's going to get caught up. Another cocoon landing here from Revolta. But meanwhile, the all-in in the mid lane. Left comes down, though, trying to answer the kill onto Kame, but Revolta flashes forward. He's going to be the death sentence. Revolta may need to be a little bit careful. Tempered Fate comes down. Tower not going to be doing anything. The cocoon perfectly timed. Down goes the boss. Arce trying to stay alive. Might actually survive this one. No! There's the rappel, and Revolta's going to lock it down. May sacrifice himself after the flash there from Theak. There are so many dead. It's a 2-for-2.
Definitely sacrificed himself with the Rift Herald buff as well.
Not great.
An even trade honestly favors the Latin America side there. Kami went down super early in that fight. The Malphite does a lot of damage, but it's not going to be enough to sway the rest of the battle without that Victor there. So all of this time, someone else has been doing work in the top lane. He's destroying it.
Yeah, and you can definitely hear it orally. It just sounds fantastic. Helio able to smack down that turret. So that is going to be turret number one for the Latin American side, answering the one already taken here from Brazil on that bottom side of the map. Oh, the top side, sorry.
Yeah. Different definitions of fantastic, I think we have, Max.
Yeah, well.
It's not what I would define as a fantastic sound, to say the least, but...
Really? The flacking?
Yeah.
It doesn't feel like super... Okay.
It's just not great.
I find it satisfying.
When you're playing the Jax, I'll agree with that.
Oh, yeah. But if you're watching him destroy your stuff, probably not as good.
So both junglers right now are massive. They've got a 3-1 Evelynn, they've got a 4-1 Elise, and Revolta, known for taking over the map, well, now it's on Theak to do the same thing himself. He needs to actually have a very big presence in the rest of this game. The only problem with that is Miss Fortune's got her item.
Yes. And there's also the fact that Theak has gone towards that Runeglaive as well when Revolta has picked up the Cinderhulk, so... They're going to have a lot of extra, I guess, damage out of Theak, but he's still incredibly squishy as this Evelynn, despite having that side stone. Volta trying to get some invades happening here. I believe that was Fate's call. Just thought I heard the sound. Volta's going to steal away this blue buff.
It's actually quite clever from Loop there on the Bard. He throws down the Shrine in where he didn't have vision because he didn't want to place the ward that deep. He runs the risk of being caught out of position.
Yeah.
And now they've moved their way towards the next objective, or not.
Yeah, there's the Tempered Fate. Theak is going to get caught out. There's the Gravity Field, but fantastic use of the Dark Passage. Arce, he wants to get right back in there. There's 5 members of Brazil. It's the double hit on the ultimate out of LEP, and Theak, he has to run for the hills as well. Helior trying to be the hero. Loop taking so much damage, but it's not enough. And they're cleaning house, the Brazilian squad. It's 3 dead, and the rest limping away.
And they can very easily siege or go back to the dragon after that one. Complete control now in this Brazilian side. That was a very good combo. The Malphite misfortune is throwing
ridiculous.
Back to season 1 and 2, back when it was ridiculous. And we've gone full circle one more time.
Certainly have. BRTT able to get that in exactly the right spot. But LEP really making things happen on this Malphite.
This was very good play from Loop. Watch the stun from Bard as well. It still connects all of that distance. They try and make something happen here. Very good from Archie. Very good from Theak to try and get some damage down. But this is just gross.
Silly.
And the crit comes out of Helio. Tries very hard to take someone down. Revolta's destroying people in the meanwhile. This Brazilian side, if they can put it together, and I will say executing is easier than the Latin American side, they should be able to just stay ahead where they are now.
Yeah, and Sayer as well, a little bit late to that party, as you can see. Tried to get a queue off, but that stage it was against four members of Brazil, still relatively healthy. And it'll take a little bit more out of this Latin American side to get this game moving in towards their favor. And you can see it's CS advantages across the board. It's 10-5 in kills. 3K gold, so not too far ahead are the Brazilians at 15 minutes, but it's all starting to add up.
That is interesting. I was looking at this Kalista's build just quietly.
Yeah.
And it had a Zeal. So hang on. Why do you have a Zeal with a BF sword? And then I remembered. It gives crit now. Runan's Hurricane, first item with that crit. Actually really good if you go in the Warlord's Bloodlust.
Yeah, very true. Warlord's
in that
Bloodlust,
cunning mastery tree, because you can crit three people, heal 15% every time it crits.
And of course, you also hit a whole lot more people when you're trying to clear out a wave as well with that Hurricane.
Yeah.
So going to be making use of it, despite the fact that it now doesn't proc off minions. Hotfix actually applied here at 5.22.
But in response, of course, you want to have a look at the Misfortune on the other side. That's a BF sword. I would wager an Infinity Edge.
Yep.
And once that is complete, I don't think there's anyone that can fight this BR side.
Yeah, unless they can catch him out straight away. But as soon as he has like positioning in the back of a team fight, just opens up with that bullet time, and I think that's all she wrote, really, because it's just doing so much work.
I like that they gave the Rift Herald buff as well to BRTT, the one who shouldn't ever die. And they're going again, the bottle.
Once again, Dark Passage goes down. White Lotus is going to be safe, but they got what they wanted as the Brazilians pick up the outer turret in the mid lane. All three outers now down. The bleeding of objectives has definitely started for Latin America.
The map now completely open, of course, for them to do as they would please. The Baron's not up for 3 minutes. They have the Rift Herald, though, so they can look to siege a lane. In saying that, we've touched on the fact that it's difficult for them to siege without diving. So, here goes Jax.
Yeah, there's the flash in as Helios trying to jump onto BRTT. That Make It Rain slows him down enough, and the Jax just can't stick on this Misfortune.
Nope. Nothing the Jax can do until the stun connects, and with the flash available, the Make It Rain slow as well.
Yeah.
Very difficult for a very prolonged fight and stickiness with that engage. And saying that, the rest of the side, they're here. They are still getting what they came for.
Now, White Lotus decorating these minions here with the Renard's Hurricane while he takes down this turret. And you can see now it's Helior going towards that Rage Blade. Blasting one now in hand. But Arce has been really impressive with his Dark Passages. I have a feeling this game could be so much further in Brazil's favor if a lot of these things were going to happen. But Arce always there to throw a lamp at people.
He's also the one with two kills, so
yeah,
not ideal.
No.
To have two of your five kills on the support when you've got the Kalista and a Lissandra and a Jax who would all want those desperately. So they're making what they can out of all of these situations. It's not ideal. They did just get two turrets though, one after the other, and have started to close that gold lead.
Yeah, evening things out here. Of course, we mentioned the 3K gold lead now still there, considering the answer of those outer turrets. And we'll see, are there item spikes that we're looking for here from Latin America, or is it all to do with execution?
So they've got a big spike in the middle lane right now. They may be wanting the boots too out of Seiya. Helior in the top lane, Quinzu's Rageblade. That's on the way. He's got the Trinity Force ready to go, so he has spiked, and we saw him try and fight the Misfortune as he steals the blue.
Yeah, Revolta just claiming that one for his own. Arce going to get caught up. The Cocoon, oh, the timing. Not going to quite be there, but the flash is available from Arce anyway.
Very good play from Loop this entire game. The ultimates have connected with at least one target. For the most part, it's who they're aiming for. Therefore, forcing a flash directly after, and Lissandra's in.
Yeah, the BRTT getting caught out by the Frozen Tomb. Arce gets in there. Triple play comes down. Bullet time going to get completely destroyed, but left right in amongst the fight. Revolta as well, as everyone's trying to flash away back over the wall after him as White Lotus is trying to close the gap. LEP, he's going to sacrifice himself. Helior picks up his first kill of the game. And Latin America really playing that one well.
Caught with their pants down in the bottom lane. There was no reason for the Misfortune to be that far out. Of course, didn't have vision in the bush where the Lissandra was sitting. So smart play from the Latin American side. They seem to have been there in it. Oh my god!
Okay, Kami. This says, nope, White Lotus, you're gonna go with a gray screen for now.
Yeah. Looks like Latin America almost made it back in the game. Let's kill them again.
Yeah.
That was a lot of damage.
Pretty silly. Does have Morales Crystal Scepter and an immensely large rod there, and it seems like he had immensely large amounts of damage at the same time. We are going to see this fight one more time.
Yeah, so BRTT so far out of position. RSA plays the fight to perfection, hits the three-man play. This teleport in from Lep was basically damage control. He's going to go down regardless because he's against a Lissandra and a Jax who have a lot of control when they are ahead, and that's exactly what they're doing right there. They were winning the fight. They pushed that advantage. The rest of this Brazilian side run away with their pants between their legs.
Yeah, they most certainly did. But Revolta went back, grabbed himself the dead man's plate. 7-1-1 now on this Elise, going full tank at this stage of the game. Frozen Heart now completed here for Malphite as well, but the Rage Blade is done, Rusty.
Split push Jax is online. Team fighting Jax is online. Just Jax.
Jax is here.
Turns out Jax is now online.
He's
they
back.
They are only really waiting for maybe the Evelyn spike to an extent. The boots are now ready for Lissandra. And the next item for this Kalista, which looks to be an Amphibia.
Very interesting part there, of course, but the added grip makes a fair bit of sense.
Certainly does.
But second dragon is going to go down with no contest from Latam. They're just going to push down the mid lane. Helio actually making his way around as well. Spotted out by some wards here as Brazil try to go for what looks like a flank, but scattering of Latam, he's going to get them to safety.
The movements around the map from this Brazilian side are just without regard, and they are fighting.
Fates Call comes in. BRTT once again taken down. Revolta going to get knocked up by the Fates Call. Is going to utilize the jump away, but Helio straight over the top. Loop now in trouble as Kame right in amongst it. Tempered Fate actually going to save a whole lot of members of LATAM, and they all just jump on top. Going to get taken down by one ground slam, I believe. White Lotus is going to deal with the rest and left. Okay, he's going to fall after a decent dark passage from Arce, and it's an ace for Latin America. They only lost three.
Evelyn engaged, destroys BRTT one more time. Kami's damage was unbelievable, but this misfortune dies without the ultimate being used, and that was the difference between winning or losing that fight. So this Latin American team are playing to perfection in terms of their engages in team fights. And the Bard ultimate was almost detrimental to the team in general because it caught them all and let them get cooldowns off one more time. So Theot comes in with a great engage. Lissandra going in, destroys BRTT before he can even think about what he's meant to be doing in this team fight. Elio is very sticky on this Jax. Jumps over. The Gwinzoos is online. And that was a combo that almost won them the game. But the cooldowns were ready the second the Tempered Fate finished.
Yep.
Bard did work. But he's not the only person in this team. They needed the victor to try and put something down, and it just wasn't enough without the misfortune available, as they basically destroy Brazil.
And it would have been a whole lot closer as well, considering Lep actually missed out on taking White Lotus up with that unstoppable force. It was so incredibly close. May have made a change there. Isaiah thinking about an engage onto Revolta. But he does manage to take down that Riskaller himself.
There's also, up until this stage, a lot of armor finished by this Malphite with a lacking amount of magic resistance.
Yeah.
So, depending on the engage, if he gets White Lotus, then he's doing his job. So, as you mentioned, only just missing on the cusp of the range, essentially. Didn't get the kill he was looking for, and it backfires because he only has the armor. Of course, he has the M on him.
Yeah, it does have at least the Spectre's Cowl. See whether he's going to build towards a whole lot more of that magic resistance, but Frozen Heart, very, very useful. Jack actually going for another engage. Revolta actually says, okay, I'll take this one, as he's very tanky. Just going to get some harassment off. Brazil continues pushing up.
And now the Infinity Edge is there for this misfortune with another Brawler's Glove. What we're looking at in the next fight is if BRTT can use the ultimate, if he can actually set up in a position to hit more than two waves of it before dying. And it's very easy for him to do so if they're engaging. The problem is, this Latin American side are always the ones going in themselves. They're not giving the CB LoL side a chance to think.
Well, Tempered Fate going to get dodged out of the way here, as there's the flash forward loop. Unable to get the stun, though, as White Lotus takes a fair bit of damage. But that's going to be about it.
There's nothing Latin America can do right now besides engage or potentially flank. They've been pushed into the CB LoL jungle, and they're just stuck. So now they have to run all the way around Brazil. They're going to look for potentially there's a blue buff, I would imagine. Maybe make a pick around the blue buff. We'll see what they actually want to do from this point. But they've got control now of at least the middle area of the map. And they can either be content with forcing Latin America around the map, which they are doing, or engage again.
One thing I want to talk about, Rusty, is Baron buff. and the fact that Latin American side have a Jax and a Kalista.
Yeah.
Jax doing a heck of a lot of damage and Kalista having the most secure in the game.
So is Evelynn. Lot of damage.
Those three could take down Baron so incredibly quickly. It could be a potential way back here for Latin America as they're still behind, but not by nearly as much as they were before.
So they're definitely behind, but it doesn't feel like it.
No.
That's the difference right now, is these last two fights have actually started to tip the balance more into this Latin American side's favor. Very good individual players executing team fights at the right time is what's keeping them in this game. With that Baron buff available for them to take, they could force that. All Elior needs is a tank, and he can take that.
Yeah, precisely, and they don't necessarily have one of those.
No. So
unless Arce is going to be around there.
And therein lies the problem.
Yes, indeed. But, I mean, it can't do damage to you if it's dead. And they're going to have a fair bit of damage to do to it.
But that's a problem for more than just Baron. They're a team comp that if they get engaged on properly by CBLOL, they will die because they're not tanky.
Well, what you mentioned about this Kalista build as well seems to be coming to fruition, but with an Infinity Edge instead of that Blade of the Ruined King as that AD-based item. I actually quite like it here out of White Lotus. Of course, it doesn't help your rend all that much.
My question was always going to be if they go for the Shiv, perhaps, before they go for the Infinity Edge, or they go Shiv before Hurricane. He's gone all in for that crit. All of his sustain right now is going to come from hitting champions.
Yeah.
And one Doran's Blade.
Well, see the CBLOL side. Heading up this mid lane, Heliot remains on the bottom. Teleport's available for both top laners, though, but LEP hanging around. He is going to answer the split push here of the Jax, but Revolta now getting the vision around this Baron. But you can see lots of vision here for Latin America around the Baron buff and some deep vision in the blue side jungle of Brazil.
And this is the part that most wildcard teams all struggle with. The game's relatively even. We're at a time in the game where control of the map feels more important to these guys than actually doing the objective or taking anything, because it's just a mind battle now. Who will pull the trigger first? Who makes the first mistake? This is the part where the team that actually makes the aggressive decision properly first should actually come out ahead. This is a very volatile map right now.
It most certainly is. And when you've got teams that haven't been playing together for all that long, which is in the case of every single one of them here at IWCA, it's harder to make these decisions later in the game because they're not used to playing with each other.
The Bardolph is ready to go.
But it is going to be the Dragon taken down. There's the Bardolph, but the Cocoon's going to miss. Fantastic shield from the Agony's Embrace, but the Axe probably still will go down. Yes, Lev takes him. There's a massive Fates call out from Arce as he's getting in there, but you can see the Chaos Storm doing so much work. White Lotus has to get out of there. That death ray probably would have been enough. You can see it's a one for nothing. Latin America trying to escape. BRTT still alive, wanting revenge.
They're still going.
Oh my god. Journey. Oh my goodness. They are trying to get the work done. Helior jumps back in. They do manage to pick up two. But now, I believe they're going to try and get out.
That was insane. They managed to try and get... They got something out of what was definitely nothing. Over-aggression from Loop one more time. Always takes that magical journey in and just didn't have the vision ready to go. But an aggressive flash from Seiya, something that was definitely not predicted to happen, is exactly what did happen. This Tempered Fate was great. The Cocoon was not. And now gets a massive shield. Keeps him alive for so long. The biggest thing here, though, watch the Thresh.
Fantastic.
Plays zones with the ultimate, and then they just focus left, and they focus Revolta. They do have to run away, but if that Thresh didn't do all of that work, they would have lost this fight, probably as an ace. Seiya goes over this wall, loops like, you know what, guys? Let's do it. Flashed and absolutely obliterated. Helior was not ready to back it up, though, as Elise kind of flashed into the damage.
Not great.
And kind of died from that.
But RTT survived. That is the main thing. Able to get a little bit more damage down and pressure the rest of these lanes. You can see Latin America trying to continue with the vision around the Baron, but unable to get rid of all of the wards.
It's an aggressive item build from this Jax. Gone for the Steric Gauge as well, so there's not really a way that the Malphite could ever even look at him the wrong way without dying now. So the split push is a very real option for this Latin American side. In saying that, just as easy to then dive if you were the CBLOL team. They've got that Malphite ready to go. It all comes down to if they can do that, because if you dive wrong against an Evelynn, Thresh, Lissandra, you lose the game not only through that team fight but through split pushing.
And it seems like White Lotus, he's just going all in for the team fight. He now has the Phantom Dancer as well. The extra movement speed, the extra ability to be even more slippery. as this Kalista is going to be ridiculous.
It's actually great. If you look at the damage that the Malphite's doing to him right now, it's base damage because he's building exclusively tank items. If you reduce that by 12%, that base damage is very insignificant. It's all about the crowd control then. So if he can auto-attack the Malphite before they engage, auto-attack the Elise as well, who's going full tank, then it's actually a very good item. I think Phantom Dancer is ridiculous.
It's very, very strong. We'll see whether he can make use of it in the next fight, of course. May need some defensive item in the next little while, and we'll see whether anyone's going to be building the Last Whisper and the different Last Whispers, different options, whether we're going to have Grievous Wounds being put down, whether it's going to be something else, but it is going to be the Inner Turret traded for what looks like the Baron.
This
here
is a very risky trade. The Latin American side, they're not slowing down. Into the base.
They're looking for it. Of course, the Inhibitor Turret now under fire. Everyone empowered recalling back. It looks like this Inhibitor Turret is going to fall as Thiak is going to take that one, but not going to get the Inhibitor, and that is the big deal. It's now Helior continuing the split. They are going to move down. Tempered Fate going to lock down the turret and actually might buy Brazil enough time. It is.
It's going to buy them time. They're going to save that turret at the very least. This Latin American side have now opened the middle lane completely to their regard. They've got no turret to stop them from just rushing down there and going for the Inhibitor, but they do not have the Baron buff available to them from the map pressure that they just gained. That was taken by Brazil, and what they need to do now, Brazil, with this Baron buff, is essentially push down the lane that's at risk.
Yep.
And try and win a team fight with the buff. Get some control of the map, take down turrets, and get it back in their favor.
Yeah, we could be looking towards the end of the game here as well, Rusty. I mean, if the Brazilian side are able to win a fight with that Baron buff, they'll be able to take the base almost too easily now with the amount of damage that's available for BRTT. Not to mention Kami as well, able to get a whole lot of auto-attack damage based on his AP.
That was a Thornmail just bought from this Malphite as well when he recalled. I was wondering why he was going to go back. Did have the teleport, bought a Thornmail, and he's now against the side that Phantom Dancer's great. Last Whisper is not an efficient item, to say the least anymore. It's bonus penetration. It's not a flat percentage rate.
That being said, he's getting a fair bit of value against a 3 armor item Malphite.
Yeah. No, he'd be getting a lot of value.
Yeah.
But it's still very hard to kill this Malphite, who is going to be infinitely more tanky than you would imagine with his very efficient armor items.
We'll see whether White Lotus is going to be able to pick up the sort of extra health damage as well that you can now augment your Last Whisper with. But he's going to be very difficult to kill that. That is, there is no doubt in anyone's mind that guy is a bit of a beast. BF Sword now completed on top of the rest of the items for White Lotus. It's coming.
Oh, wow.
Maybe caught out of position. Thiak not wanting to fully commit as Fate's Call comes in. There's the slow bullet time comes down. Thiak actually flashing out of the way as the Tempered Fate did come down. You're right, but not too much. And it looks like Brazil really trying to go for a fight, but unable to really get it.
Jax is having a bit of a battle right now with the Malphite, which means he's not able to teleport in. Neither of them are able to teleport into that fight. A lot of poke. Thiak felt the need to go in. He wanted to try and find a pick, and he does a lot of damage to Kami.
Oh, yeah.
Kami reciprocates that damage, though, very effectively. And an all-around disengage as the Misfortune ult was also used in that last fight, but to no avail on either side. Saying that, if there's spells down from Latin America and the Baron buff is still available for this Brazilian team, they could force something in another lane.
Well, Dragon is now back up again. Of course, Brazil looking for their third. Some extra movement speed could be good to get into the right positions for these fights, but Latin America want to be able to stop the storm. The potential fifth Dragon might be there. I wasn't expecting to talk about fifth Dragon all that much here on this preseason patch. But things have slowed down, and it is still a 3,000 gold lead here for Brazil.
Always going to be a consideration is that Dragon. It sneaks up on you.
It does.
And it scales very well. The move speed, if they get this one in particular. Evelyn's looking cheeky.
Yeah, Jack looking for it. Saya goes in. There's the Zonya's Hourglass as well as BRTT trying to get out bullet time over two members, but he gets knocked up and destroyed as Latin America are just going to town on the Brazilians left. He's going to get taken out. It's a double kill for Helior. And they only lost Thiak.
When Brazil turned that fight around, it looked like it was going to go perfectly well for them. But White Lotus and Arce play perfectly around that Kalista ultimate, pull him in, knock up the Misfortune, and prevent any further damage from that crit combo on top of the Malphite ultimate. All the while, Elliot, the rest of this side are just destroying them.
Arce has been so impressive as well.
Yeah. he's hitting all of the plays that he could possibly want to. The hooks connect, and just the teamwork that seems to be coming out of these guys is, it's not even necessarily teamwork, it's individual strength.
Yeah, and Helio, he's going to take the Dark Passage to safety. They still have an open inhibitor in the mid lane. And Latin America, the underdogs here, finally with the gold lead.
So this is a great play from Zayn, straight into Carvey, but he has the QS set, so the damage is dropped. Left with the teleport, and this is great, but that Fate's Call that comes out of Thresh knocks them up, prevents anything further. Immediately, the second that gets cancelled, any semblance of winning that fight was completely out the window.
Yeah, there were so many sort of minor turnarounds in that teamfight that happened within about 2 seconds. Love to, like, the hyper slow-mo possibly come out for that one. We'll see whether we can get that one happening, but it is going to be the Dragon taken down. Brazil still have control of that objective now, 3-1. 19-17, so of course still in the lead. There was a blink of a moment where Latin America did have the lead. But
well, I wouldn't call this a lead by
any means. Yeah, it's 300 gold. That's a good point.
It's a longsword. That's probably the difference between them right now.
Or a dagger.
Or no, not 300? Even a dagger. It's 300 now.
Yeah, that's what I mean.
I'm sorry, I was looking at 400 when I said
that. Yeah, BRTT is going to come in. BRTT, they're looking to try and take him down, but my god, the explosion that is Kame's damage. Arce, he's going to get taken down as well. White Lotus did get rid of BRTT, but look, I have a feeling that they are at least prepared for the Ultra Tunnel.
You need to respect Kame. They focused him in the first fight. His engage, the ultimate that he dropped down was not great, but in this one, if you're going for BRTT and you're leaving Kame unattended, he will actually blow you up.
He did.
He has the Void Star. He is ready to go and can out-team fight the entirety of Latin America if you do not focus him.
Well, Sayer trying to do his best to clear out these minions. Of course, no Baron buff available.
Oh,
Helios just trying to kill himself onto left. As, I believe as that Rageblade stacks up, he might be able to turn this one around, but he's going to use the Leap Strike to get over. No ultimate.
Bud's here.
Yep, in he comes, trying to land this stun. Revolt is here as well, just gonna use a repel for funsies as Kame's gonna get this kill delivered to him. Oh, the flash up to Helios!
He's gone!
Had the ult running as well, the Grandmaster's Might was there. Tempered Fate though, right in the middle. Blue's just showing off at this stage. The jump back in as Helios takes forever to die.
He tried really hard to stay alive, but it was just buying time because it was an inevitable fate. They don't push down the middle lane also. Everyone besides Elio is now alive, ready to go.
Yep, Dark Passage is going to be thrown out here as the blue buff steel comes in. Baron is going to be up in another 7 seconds. The dangerous thing is that Helio doesn't have his teleport for when he comes up in 30 seconds. It's going to give the Brazilian squad a whole lot of time to consider this Baron buff.
Yeah, and you can see the focus immediately from this Latin American team. Try and clear the Baron, clear as much as we can, and work from there. Pressuring the middle lane, controlling the waves, just doing whatever they can as a preventative measure to stay alive, stay in the game, prevent the Baron from going down.
Man, Revolta so aggressive right there, just trying to get in amongst it. Latin America pulling all the way back. 5 seconds now on this Jax, and Brazil looks like they may not be able to make it happen in
time.
Still
no teleport.
No. Looking to try and bait it out at this stage. Nice pink ward coverage here from Latin America. They're just blue trinkets going everywhere. Oh my goodness, the Ak getting taken down so incredibly quickly. Bullet time soaked up by the Zonya's Hourglass, but it doesn't matter. He was down to about 100 health. There's now Brazil looking to try and close this one. Only one kill though. Arce trying to get out of here. The slow comes in. Fate's Call comes out. They didn't want to use that cooldown, but they were forced to.
Definitely playing with awareness of cooldowns, knowing that Kalista ultimate was there, so they did not overcommit unless they could get in range of White Lotus. In saying that, they do make a great pick on Athea. They go straight for the Baron, and this is a big risk if Helios wants to steal it.
Yeah, well, Helios looking to try and get something done, but with no Smite, it's going to be very, very hard. White Lotus over the backside, wants to try and get a Pierce into it, throws out a Rend as well, but I think Revolta pretty much had that one on lockdown.
Definitely had that on lockdown. Now another Baron for this CB LoL site. They didn't lose the middle inhibitor, they did lose the bottom one. So the minions naturally pushing towards that. It should be up reasonably soon though, to say the least. So there's still damage control, but they're well and truly in control of these next fights, or forcing them. Jax is just gross.
Yeah, he is. Clearing out this minion wave relatively quickly with this Rageblade stacked up as well as that passive. So Helio going to at least try and stop the top lane siege. Can't push too far in. He's going to get pinged down. They're going to have to see to that minion wave first. White Lotus now with the Bloodthirst, now has the Spectre's Cowl at the same time, looking to try and grab himself a Banshee's Veil. Stop that initial engage.
Yeah, it's actually a Bloodthirster out of White Lotus. Yeah. Opposed to a Last Whistbone. We mentioned it, it's only bonus that you get as an increase opposed to a flat percentage armor penetration. Not necessarily worth having it, especially if you can ignore Lep on this Malphite,
well,
who
it's
only
what
has
be doing.
Tank items.
Oh my goodness.
A lot of them, actually.
Yeah, Randuin's Omen now completed. So
that's a full build.
That's five armor items as well here for this Malphite, with the cheeky Banshee's Veil chucked in as well.
He's also winning lane against the Jax, of all things.
Yeah.
So he's doing very well here, Lep.
Up by 60 CS, just being able to pick up a lot of that empty lane farm. You can see him in the bottom lane now, just splitting away. BRTT strutting it up. Looks like the Latin American side able to defend this turret.
It's at the point now where the Elise has definitely fallen off. Had a lot of early pressure with all of those kills and was a beast because ahead with tank items is always ahead. Revolta, still ahead, still very tanky, but the impact that he's got on the map isn't as high now. So you're looking towards entirely Kami, BRTT, and Lep's ultimate.
Well, Helio, we're going to try and get it amongst it, stop Lep from pushing this one down, but his shield barely got taken off. Brazil are going to be able to siege down the top lane. So the split push working here from this Malphite as he was able to draw down Helior.
I would also suggest lifesteal, honestly, if I were the Jax.
Yeah.
Go for a Hextech Gunblade, you could actually out-sustain the Malphite's damage that he's doing right now, which somehow, with five tank items, is poking him down.
Yeah, also the Thornmail not quite working here for Helior as he tries to auto-attack through the rock. Fourth Dragon now to be taken here as Brazil uncontested once again. Latin American side, I mean, they've had some fantastic team fights throughout this game, but it just hasn't quite been enough.
But
stop the CBLOL.
Again, CBLOL, they can't end the game. They're struggling to get into the base. They can't break it. It is so difficult for them. Every time they try, they get flanked by Evelynn, and it's an even fight. No matter how far ahead they have been, I think this is the furthest they've ever been.
The ridiculous thing as well is that Fiax is still building damage.
Yeah.
He's got another needlessly large rod. Might be towards Luden's Echo. Might be towards something like a Rabadon's Deathcap, just to try and augment the three AP items that he already has built up. When that Agony's Embrace goes down, that is so much percent health damage, especially when, I mean, if he manages to hit Lep before that Banshee's Veil, I mean, after that Banshee's Veil gets taken down, that's still a heck of a lot of damage to the Malphite.
It definitely is. The magic damage is the biggest weakness here for this Malphite, so if Lissandra actually puts down the damage, Evelynn...
That's a very good point.
And I'd say half of Jax, but it doesn't feel that way. There's actually a real possibility that the Malphite isn't as tank as he otherwise looks, but he is beyond tanky for White Lotus. White Lotus should just ignore his existence, work everywhere else,
yep,
and try and take people down. But you have to respect a Malphite with ult.
Certainly do. And Lep has been able to get in the right positions there with that Unstoppable Force to try and make sure Latin American side are having a bad day. Theak just chilling, watching Revolta.
They're putting wards down top lane, they're pushing the wave top lane, they're then recalling and going bottom lane or mid. Brazil are being very inefficient right now with what they're actually trying to do. This is going to be potentially a recurring problem with all-star teams, is their ability to close out a game as a team, set up and do things,
yeah,
without having to say to this person, you do this, you do this. They don't have to delegate, but in this, in an all-star game, delegation's actually going to have to be very important. Because right now, they're not on the same page. They can't break the base.
Yeah, and if we're talking about sort of what this gold means, at this stage, I mean, that's a six-item Misfortune. She's never going to get any stronger. Six-item Malphite there as well. And a six-item Kami, who is literally gigantic in the mid lane. He's got so much AP. The Deathcap and the Rylai's Crystal Scepter, not to mention the Lich Mane as well. I mean, he could be selling boots fairly soon.
He doesn't have a Void. Doesn't have a Zonya's Hourglass, though. He's gone for the,
yeah,
Lich Mane build. And against this side of Latin America, well, they can blow him up.
We'll see whether they are able to as BRTT makes his way around. Dark Passage going to be taken to stop Helior from being in the wrong position. But, oh my goodness, the Brazilian team.
Of all things, if this works.
The Gang Rush.
This is going to be the ultimate patience play. thank God. I was going to say, there's not even minions to do this.
Like, no.
What?
And, yeah, Latin America just go mid lane. We've got an open inhibitor, guys. Let's just move towards
two
there.
Of them, in fact.
Yeah.
CBLOL can't afford to make a mistake. This Brazilian all-star team, need to be on the front foot. They need to force Latin America around the map. If they can ever get a cheeky engage in or a cheeky push, they will bleed objectives.
Well, every summoner spell is available. 7,000 gold is the lead, but at this point, 45 minutes in, gold is starting to mean less
and less.
This turret,
by the way, in the bottom lane is actually starting to get quite low from this Malphite.
Yeah, he's actually able to take it down. Yeah, you can see Heliod trying to do some work here as Counter-Strike comes in, going to get the stun off. But Lep is just soaking damage. Heliod, I don't think he's taken a spell from
Lep. Get him, Heliod!
And he's trying to kill himself on the big rock guy. Bad news, there's another Counter-Strike to come in, and this is the longest battle I've ever seen in my life. Unstoppable Force is still there. Meanwhile, there's a fight in the mid lane. Stack's going to use the Zhonya's Hourglass. Massive shield there as well as Luke. He's taking a lot of damage. White Lotus untouched in the back line. The shutdown onto Kami. Bullet Time comes in. He's going to take down Sayer as Revolta. Very tanky. Oh, not quite enough on the Rend. And now BRTT looking to try and take over.
They're not done here, it feels like. White Lotus. Oh, that was close.
Man, that double up. I was actually expecting it to kill him.
Yeah, he did thankfully get over that wall. Otherwise, that could have
been... He also had full health. But still, part of my mind is like, no, he's dead.
Look, probably not. Saying that, 2 seconds till the Baron was up. That is where they're going to look towards, I would imagine. But there are so many people dead across the board. No idea what happened with the Jax and the Malphite. They were just butting heads for a very long period of time.
I think Helio gave up.
Malphite's ult is down, so... I mean, they butted heads until someone pulled the trigger.
Yeah, and in the end, Helio just said, well, I can't kill you, so I guess we're done here. 6 items, though, as the Dead Man's Plate was picked up from the Jax. Luden's Echo was the option here for Thiac. Just wants to augment all those hate spikes.
Banshee's Veil as well for White Lotus is actually super important. If you look at what's actually going to engage from this CB low side, Malphite. And maybe a Bard Ultimate and an Elise Cocoon would be like the ideal engages. Bard Ultimate, you can basically get out of your Kalista anyway. Unless Loop plays Godlike. The Malphite Ultimate, if you have a Banshee's Veil, will be huge.
Most certainly will. We'll see what's going to happen. Of course, there's one item slot that's open. And it's Thiac. And he can build whatever he wants. Probably avoid stuff. I'd recommend, you know, continue on your path.
Yeah, why not? Yeah. He actually needs it. I would wager.
But Latin America looking to try and take down this Baron. It's very, very low. White Lotus will have a lot of sticks to put in it. Cocoon is going to go wide now as Lep is going to teleport in. Arce completely off to the side as Sayer wants to find an option. Oh, Death Sentence almost wandered back into there from Revolta. But
Loop could have hit all of them.
Yeah.
With his Bard Ultimate, but he chose to put it on the Baron because they didn't see how low it was. And that was a big mistake if they were looking to engage. What that says to me is they were looking to push them off and not engage.
Oh my goodness, Fifth Dragon is coming in right now. BRTT is there taking that one out. There's the Death Sentence that comes down. Revolta is gonna get exploded. They've got the Fifth Dragon buff though as they're trying to get back in. They traded for the Spider Lady as Kami. Oh, misses the Blade from Arce, but isn't gonna matter. So much damage from the Bullet Time, but White Lotus is gonna survive for now. Left taking some damage. White Lotus takes him out. BRTT, oh, Death Sentence wandered out of the way of. And BRTT could take this one completely over. Take down the first member. And my goodness, this Misfortune is so frightening on the Rift right now.
Is he going to go for the Baron?
I don't know.
No. Okay. Oh my god.
Oh, trying to run out of the way. Tempered Fate. Oh, it's going to land. White Lotus has to watch himself get obliterated. BRTT is going to lock that one down, but it is still a man advantage for the Latin American side.
Oh, hello.
Is the Axe just going to backdoor the bottom lane? Okay.
I mean, it's going to come down pretty much entirely to Sayer and Arce right now. If they can stop this Misfortune, then they'll be fine.
Looking difficult at this stage as BRTT is able to get the damage down. And look, there's the Death Sentence. I mean, sorry, the Dark Passage. And Thiac, he's going to take another one. Okay. There it
one
is.
One for two.
Yep, one for two at this stage. 9 seconds on Revolta. He's going to be the next one up, but that's going to be 2 inhibitors. Sneaky, sneaky is the Evelynn. Death Sentence going to land on a loop. Not sure what Arce is going to be able to do here. Make It Rain comes down. So it is going to be 2 inhibitors for 2 inhibitors.
Making the best out of a bad situation. Thiac with the back door after the team fight is actually the saving grace of his team right now. The Baron is still available, and the bottom lane for both sides is actually matched, so there's no direct advantage, besides potentially a minion stack, as you can see where it's sitting at the moment.
I'm just thinking about, like, as far as a backdoor situation is concerned, who would you vote for? And I'd probably put me money on a Jax.
Yeah. If anyone was going to backdoor right now, a Jax could probably solo take the turret, if not the whole game. They're doing the Baron, though. CB lol, this Brazil
so
side.
So quickly as well. Sayer looking to try and find his way in. He's going to get there. Kami's going to get exploded. Not quite enough damage, though. Sayer does get the last Q, but they trade each other. VRTT with massive damage. The Agonese Embrace is there, but Siak is going to get destroyed. Helio gets caught by the Tempered Fate, the Cocoon as well. And the Jax, who was huge, the possible backdoor threat, is going to fall down after a heck of a lot of bashing people. And it is 3-1 in favor of Brazil. What an epic battle here for Latin America, but it looks like this might be the last nail in this metaphorical coffin.
The sister regions, they've brought it to each other in this first game, but if this isn't the ending, I would be very surprised. 40 seconds on Seiya, and he's the first one up with three people dead. This should be the game, unless White Lotus goes out of his mind. Amazing.
Yeah, well, there's the bullet time. BRTT looking to try and pick up some extra kills as White Lotus. Oh, Arce! Not quite there, because BRTT, he's running forward. He's taken down the Kalista and the turrets. And I'd have to say the Nexus as well after that, as CB LOL, man, this Brazilian side, after an epic clash, 52 minutes. And on preseason, we were not expecting games of this length, but man, what an exciting one to start with.
The average game is sub 30.
Yeah.
And we come into the first one at 50 minutes. This was a very, very back and forth game. Brazil, they came out of the gate strong. They looked like they're going to be a fantastic side moving into the rest of this game. But Latin America, they showed they have what it takes. They know how Brazil works, it feels
yeah.
like. And they played around that very well.
Yeah, there were like three team fights in a row there where Latin America were able just to pick apart this Brazilian squad, make sure that all this AoE that they had at their disposal just didn't work.
Exactly right. And I mean, Theok going, the damage-based Evelynn
yeah.
build actually did so much work. Seiya was unbelievable. This Latin American mid laner
yeah.
showed up massive in that game. Of all things, he kept them in the game the longest. Arce played perfect, but this Brazilian side, they just feel like a ridiculously good team on paper. And eventually, when all it came down to was one person making a good play, that's all it took, they won.
Yeah, and I have to hand it to Revolta as well. His plays around the map in the early game really set the tone for how that game was going. And Latin America, despite having those team fights able to get back amongst it, they just couldn't overcome what was already such a massive early game advantage that Revolta was able to set up.
Yeah, it also hit the point in the game where the engage from Latin America was lacking, and they were against two really hyper carry champions. The Victor was doing ridiculous damage.
Yeah.
The Misfortune, you don't even need to describe it. She went for the fifth dragon. She came to the Baron once her team was dead and destroyed everybody.
Yeah, just ridiculous. But we have